Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Desert Fox, The Storied Military Career of Erwin Rommel, by Samuel W. Mitcham, Jr. Narrated by Nigel Patterson. Preface. The Desert Fox. The words conjure the image of a sunburned and dust-covered military genius, an incredibly tough soldier, a mentally sharp warrior making snap decisions and hatching brilliant plans on the fly, not only surviving but conquering, directing his battered panzers with extreme courage and daring, winning victory after victory against overwhelming odds. Bold attacks, stubborn defences, and relentless pursuits fill the mind's eye. And murder does not come to mind, as it does in the contemplation of other theatres in Nazi Germany's war. Erwin Rommel fought a war without hate, and he insisted that his men do the same. In the end, the numbers finally caught up with him, and his enemies managed to concentrate overwhelming forces against him, although it is an open question whether he would have ever been defeated had it not been for the genius of the Führer. And even though Rommel ultimately lost, his name still conjures respect and even admiration among his former enemies. When people are asked to identify the best general in World War II, they almost invariably name Rommel or Patton. Adolf Hitler once called Erwin Rommel the most hardened man he ever knew. He was, in a sense. He was hard on his men, harder on his officers, and harder still on himself. But he was never brutal. He served Germany and his own ambition with a single-minded determination. When he realized that the leader he served was an evil man, leading Germany to destruction, he turned against him. Being first and foremost a man of action, he prepared to act. The Nazis were fortunate that he was wounded when he was, because there is no doubt, in my mind at least, that he would have carried out his threat to open up the Western Front, order his men to stop fighting and let the Allies pour through, allowing them to win the war without any further fighting, and thus end Hitler's regime. In the end, confronted with the choice of standing trial, attempting to shoot his way out of a house surrounded by the SS and Gestapo, or committing suicide and thereby saving his family, he took cyanide. He didn't even have to think about it. When he got into the car for his death ride, he never looked back. This also was typical of the man. The purpose of this book is to tell the story of Erwin Rommel, the man. He had some magnificent, highly praiseworthy qualities. This will annoy some people who don't believe in heroes who are unable to claim the label politically correct. These people will probably not enjoy this book. That's tough. Maybe they can get a refund. Here is an even more earth-shattering thought. Maybe they should listen to it anyway. Perhaps they'll learn something. I admit that it's not likely, but we live in hope. The Desert Fox also had his share of flaws. There hasn't been a perfect man for 2,000 years, and Rommel was not an exception. The purpose of this book is to portray Erwin Rommel, warts and all. But I will give you my conclusion right now. The positives in Rommel's character outweighed the negatives. I hope the listener agrees and enjoys the book. Thanks go to the late Theodor Friedrich von Stauffenberg for leaving me his papers, Colonel Marino for giving me photographs, and all the archivists, librarians, and professors who helped along the way. Special thanks go to my long-suffering wife, Donna, who never dreamed when she accepted that date 30 years ago that she would end up proofreading and assisting in the production of dozens of military history books, not to mention changing a few thousand diapers. But it has been an adventure. Samuel W. Mitcham, Jr., Monroe, Louisiana, September 2017. Chapter 1. The Early Years. Erwin Johannes Eugen Rommel, the future Desert Fox, was born in Heidenheim-Württemberg, in the southwestern region of Imperial Germany known as Swabia, a few miles north of Ulm, on November the 15th, 1891. He was the third of five children born to Erwin Sr., a teacher and headmaster of a secondary school, and his wife Helena. Like many German fathers in that day, Erwin's father was a strict parent, with a walrus moustache and slicked down hair parted in the middle. The thing Erwin remembered most about him was that he was always asking educational questions, which annoyed his son, who had little enthusiasm for academics. Young Rommel's mother, Helena von Lutz-Rommel, was the oldest daughter of the president of the provincial government of Württemberg. However, Herr Rommel did not want a political career, as such a match might imply. Erwin Sr. wanted to settle down with his bride, have a family, and enjoy a stable, comfortable, middle-class German life. And that is exactly what he did. Their first child, Manfred, was born in 1888, but died young. The second child, Helena, became a teacher like her father and never married. The future field marshal was the third child. He was followed by Karl, who became an airline pilot, flew combat reconnaissance missions during World War I in Egypt and Palestine, and earned several decorations before malaria crippled him. He died on August the 22nd, 1918. Rommel's youngest brother, Gerhard, was the black sheep of the family. He aspired to be an opera singer, but never achieved much success, on stage or off. Rommel was weak and sickly as an adolescent. He didn't like to play games with the other children. He preferred to keep to himself, daydreaming. He had no interest in athletics, girls, or hobbies. He was a lethargic child and a mediocre elementary school student at best. A teacher once remarked that if Erwin ever earned 100% on a spelling test, he would declare a school holiday. For once, the future field marshal sat straight up at his desk. Although the instructor was being sarcastic, Rommel took him seriously. Before long, another examination was given, and this time the future desert fox spelled every word correctly. But when the promised holiday did not materialize, he relapsed into his lassitude. Then, as a teenager, Erwin Rommel suddenly woke up. He started a physical fitness program and systematically conditioned his body, much as young Theodore Roosevelt did. He exercised, played tennis, bicycled, and learned how to ski and ice skate. Before long, Erwin was exhibiting the characteristics of a typical Swabian: self-reliance, pragmatism, thrift, a strong work ethic, and a stubbornness bordering on pig-headedness. He was a simple person, and would remain unsophisticated until the day he died. Rommel's childhood was secure, comfortable, and unremarkable. From his teenage years until the end of his life, Rommel focused on the practical, rather than on philosophy, theory, or religion. Rommel was evangelical Lutheran, but not very demonstrative about his faith. Under other circumstances, he would have made a fine engineer. At the age of 14, he and a friend built a full-size glider in a field near Aalen, and it actually flew, although not very far. A remarkable achievement for a pair of teenagers, especially in 1906, only 3 years after the Wright brothers' historic flight. As he neared the time for higher education, Erwin Rommel had to choose a career. He and his father discussed the matter, and two choices presented themselves: a military officer or a teacher. Rommel decided to become a soldier. At first, his father was not convinced this was the wisest choice. There was no military tradition in the family, except in the case of Professor Rommel himself, who had been a reserve lieutenant of artillery. But when he saw that his son's mind was made up, he supported him and wrote him a letter of recommendation. The young man had a definite knack for mathematics, so he applied for an appointment as a Fahnenjunker, literally officer cadet, that is, an officer candidate, in the engineer branch, but he was rejected. An application to the artillery branch met with the same fate. Finally, he applied to the infantry, the toughest and least romantic of all the branches. Here he was accepted. Erwin Sr. had to agree to pay for his son's initial upkeep, to pay for a minor operation to correct a hernia, and to buy him a uniform. In those days, junior officers served Kaiser and Fatherland pretty much at their own expense. On July the 19th, 1910, the 18-year-old Swabian became an officer cadet in the 124th 6th Württemberger Infantry Regiment at Weingarten in southwestern Germany. Young Rommel was a handsome, blue-eyed, well-built man of just below average height. Alone and away from home for the first time, he met Walburga Stemmer, an 18-year-old fruit seller. She was not particularly good-looking, but the lonely young Rommel was drawn to her, and they became lovers. In March 1911, after 9 months of regimental duty, Cadet Rommel achieved one of his life's ambitions. He was sent to the War Academy at Danzig to undergo officer training. Here, at Imperial Germany's equivalent to Officers' Candidate School, Rommel did well in rifle and drill work, but was only adequate in gymnastics, riding and fencing. His efficiency report noted that he was rather awkward and delicate, but had immense willpower and was firm of character. It concluded that he would be a useful soldier. At Danzig, Erwin Rommel met another girl, Luzi Maria Molin. She was slender and very attractive, with a dark complexion, black hair, and a fine figure. Her deceased father had been a West Prussian landowner and the headmaster of a secondary school. Luzi was an excellent dancer and was in town to study languages. She could speak French, Italian, Spanish, English, and Polish. She considered Rommel too serious at first, but she soon fell for the handsome Fenrich, senior officer cadet, and they were apparently lovers by the time he received his commission in January 1912. She was Catholic and he was Lutheran, but they did not let religion get in their way. They considered themselves informally engaged when Second Lieutenant Rommel returned to his regiment at Weingarten. He and Luzi wrote to each other every other day, but this did not stop young Rommel from also resuming his affair with Walburga. Then, in 1913, Rommel received what was probably the greatest shock of his young life. Walburga Stemmer was pregnant. When Erwin learned that Walburga was with child, he wanted to resign from the army and marry her, even though he had no way to support a wife and child. His family talked him out of it. Herr Rommel, who died later that year, wanted young Erwin to stay in the military, and his mother correctly considered Walburga, who was the daughter of a seamstress, unsuitable to be the wife of an officer in class-conscious Wilhelmian Germany. Also, it was evident that war might break out at any time. To resign at this point could well be interpreted as an act of cowardice, something Second Lieutenant Rommel could not abide. He broke it off with Walburga. Gertrud Stemmer, Erwin Rommel's first child, was born on December 8, 1913. Although he contributed financially to Gertrud's support for the rest of his life, Rommel's desire for Walburga cooled. He was in love with Luzi. He told her about his indiscretion. The exact details of what Erwin said to Luzi and vice versa have been lost to us, but we do know that Luzi forgave him and even accepted Gertrud as a member of the family after they were married. Lieutenant Rommel and his daughter, whom he affectionately referred to as Little Mouse, remained close for the rest of his life. When World War I broke out in 1914, he instructed his sister Helena Rommel to look after Walburga and his daughter, and he listed Gertrud as the beneficiary of his life insurance policy. Walburga remained faithful to Rommel and convinced herself that he would return to her someday. She died in 1928. After her mother's death, Gertrud would spend a great deal of time with the Rommels. She was introduced to people as a cousin. During World War II, she knitted her father a plaid scarf, which he habitually wore during the Desert War. Gertrud kept in touch with Rommel until his death in 1944, and she remained close to Luzi and Manfred, Luzi and Rommel's son, even after the war. It was not until Gertrud's death in 2000 that her relationship to Rommel was discovered. She married and left behind a son, Rommel's grandson, Josef Pan, who was 72 in 2012. Back in Weingarten, Erwin Rommel had rejoined the 124th Infantry Regiment and was given the task of training new recruits for the 7th Company. He naturally did a good job, but his work would have been considered dull by many, training and drilling in a nondescript infantry regiment in an out-of-the-way part of Germany. His private life was equally uninteresting. He did not smoke, drink, or party with his young peers. On the job, he was all business. He had a hard streak, exhibiting no tolerance for the inefficient. He also developed a certain class consciousness. This social awareness did not evolve into class hatred or reverse snobbery, for he had a number of aristocratic friends. However, he was somewhat suspicious of the aristocracy, and had no use for officers who thought they should be granted rank and privilege just because of their social status. Rommel was eventually attached to the 49th Field Artillery Regiment at Ulm, 28 miles from Heidenheim, to cross-train in that branch. Ironically, his commander was the very officer who had rejected his application to join the artillery in 1910. Rommel was in Ulm when World War I broke out. He immediately rejoined the 124th Infantry Regiment as a platoon leader. Throughout Germany, and indeed throughout the entire continent, there was joy and singing. Europe entered World War I with a light heart. Both sides were sure that they would win a decisive victory in short order. The 124th was ordered to the Western Front. Rommel had a chance to see his mother, two brothers and sisters for a few moments at Kornwestheim before the locomotive blew its whistle and it was time to say goodbye. That night they crossed the Rhine. The singing and excitement had died away, and Rommel wondered, "Will I ever see my mother and family again?" Chapter 2. The Great War. Rommel fought his first skirmish in the village of Blé, Belgium. He had been on patrol for 24 hours and was suffering from stomach problems, as he often did in the 1914-15 period. Rommel had only three of his men with him, a sergeant and two privates, as opposed to around 20 Frenchmen in their forward outpost. He nevertheless dashed forward and started shooting. Several Frenchmen went down, and the rest dove for cover. Meanwhile, the rest of Rommel's platoon arrived, and the fighting became house to house. Before it was over, the entire battalion had joined in. The Germans finally overran the village and took more than 50 prisoners. Although this small battle was insignificant in and of itself, it set the pattern for Rommel's career, daring and boldness that would be seen on a much greater scale later, both in World War I and in World War II. Until now, Rommel's career had been fairly average and routine. The battlefield changed him from an ordinary, if overly serious, second lieutenant into a first-class warrior. As Desmond Young, who fought in the Indian Army against Rommel in Africa and went on to write the best-selling Rommel the Desert Fox, would explain, "From the moment that he first came under fire, he stood out as the perfect fighting animal. Cold, cunning, ruthless, untiring, quick of decision, incredibly brave." One of Rommel's colleagues said, "He was the body and soul of war." Meanwhile, in the fall of 1914, the Imperial German Army was pushing on toward Paris. They crossed the Meuse, and in the confusion came across a huge number of wounded men in the woods. "We helped them regardless of whether friend or foe," Rommel recalled. This theme was to be repeated throughout his career. Erwin Rommel believed in chivalry. He took care of the enemy's wounded, giving them the same attention he gave his own injured. He never abused or mistreated prisoners, and would not tolerate those who did. He was, however, amused that some of the Frenchmen were reluctant to surrender because they had been told that the Germans beheaded their POWs. In September, Rommel was appointed adjutant of the 2nd Battalion, a promotion of sorts. He was still sick, but refused to go to the rear to seek medical help, even after he had fainted several times. He fought in the Battle of Verdun and in the retreat through the Argonne. It was a French bullet, rather than disease, that landed him in a hospital bed. When a German attack stalled near the old Roman road west of Varennes, Rommel grabbed a rifle from a wounded soldier and charged through the bushes, where he came upon five Frenchmen 20 paces away. He gunned down two of them and pulled the trigger to shoot another, but nothing happened. Looking down, he suddenly realized that he was out of ammunition. It was too late to reload or retreat, so he charged, intent on using his bayonet. But this time the enemy was faster. One of the bullets struck him in the upper left leg and shattered the bone. "I went head over heels," Rommel recalled, and he wound up a few feet from the enemy, who was now trying to defend against the rest of Rommel's platoon. His men rescued him, but he spent the next 3 months in the hospital. Later he would comment with sarcasm, "In a man-to-man fight, the winner is he who has one more round in his magazine." Rommel was transferred to the base hospital at Stenay, where he was awarded the Iron Cross, second class. He did not return to his regiment until after the new year. The conflict was much different when Rommel returned to his regiment. The war of manoeuvring was over, and both sides were now engaged in bitter trench warfare from the Swiss border to the North Sea. The young Leutnant had proven himself and was given command of the 124th's 9th Company, but without any advance in rank. On January the 29th, 1915, during the First Battle of Argonne, Rommel crawled on his belly through a belt of barbed wire 100 yards deep, followed by 200 men. They surprised the French, overran their front line, and seized 4 important blockhouses. The enemy still outnumbered them, however, and the French were able to launch an immediate counterattack and retake one of the blockhouses. Rommel struck back quickly and retook it, but the rest of the battalion had not been able to keep up and had taken defensive positions a half mile back. Rommel realized that the unequal battle could only end one way if he allowed it to continue. He had 2 choices: to fight until he ran out of ammunition and was forced to surrender, or to retreat single file through the barbed wire entanglements, in which case he would lose half of his men. Rommel chose a third alternative. He attacked. The French, who were in their assembly areas preparing an attack of their own, were caught flat-footed and they scattered. Rommel withdrew, and while the enemy reorganized, abandoned the blockhouses and retreated to German lines before the French could bring up even more reinforcements and finish him off. For this exploit, Rommel was awarded the Iron Cross, First Class, a high decoration for a young man in 1915. Shortly thereafter, Rommel was given command of the 4th Company, 124th Infantry Regiment, which he led successfully in the trench warfare on the Western Front for several months. In July, he was wounded in the shin by shrapnel, but the injury was not serious. In late September, he was promoted to Oberleutnant, First Lieutenant. He was hoping to be transferred to the Turkish front, where his younger brother Karl was an airplane pilot, but instead he was posted to Münzingen, Germany, 23 miles west of Ulm, on October the 4th. Here, the Second Reich was forming an elite mountain unit, the Württembergische Gebirgsbataillon, the Württemberg Mountain Battalion. It was undergoing a training program which would essentially turn its men into mountain shock troops. Rommel was appointed commander of the Second Company. The High Command did not intend to commit the Württemberg Mountain Battalion to combat as a unit. Rather, they envisioned deploying the individual companies separately in more or less independent operations. This suited young Rommel perfectly. One of his platoon leaders, Lieutenant Theodor Werner, recalled that Rommel looked almost like a schoolboy, but was imbued with a holy zeal. "Anybody who once came under the spell of his personality turned into a real soldier," he recalled. Before long, in some undefinable way, his spirit transmitted itself to the men and permeated the entire battalion. World War I was not going well for Imperial Germany in 1916. The Western Front was a meat grinder, consuming hundreds of thousands of young men, who were being killed by heavy artillery fire, machine guns, and poisonous gas. Despite the bloodshed, the trench line remained more or less static. At the end of 1915, Erwin Rommel and his battalion were sent to Hilsen Ridge in the high Vosges Mountains in Alsace, on the southern sector of the Western Front. Except for patrolling and an occasional raid, this was not an active sector. There they remained for 10 months. In the autumn of 1916, the Romanian government thought territorial advantages could be gained by joining the Allies. Romania declared war on the Austro-Hungarian Empire on August the 27th and overran Transylvania. Berlin quickly sent its Feldgrau troops to aid its ally and combat the Romanian troops. The Alpenkorps, of which Rommel's battalion was a part, was in the vanguard. On November the 11th, the Alpenkorps captured the important Mount Lejoulouis with surprisingly few casualties. Rommel, however, had an entirely different kind of engagement on his mind. His commander had given him permission to marry Luzi Maria Molin. The ceremony took place in Danzig on November the 27th. They soon set out on a 2-week honeymoon. Erwin Rommel had learned his lesson from the Walburger Stämme affair. He was and would remain a devoted, faithful husband and a very domestic family man for the rest of his life. The German army made quick work of the Romanians. The Germans captured Bucharest on December the 16th and overran 2/3 of the country by the end of the year. When Rommel rejoined his company, he and his men infiltrated enemy lines and went to ground outside the village of Gagiesht, now Paragiesht, waiting for the enemy to go to sleep. Then they attacked. The drowsy Romanians put up little resistance. Rommel captured 400 men. The next day, Rommel, who had acquired a horse, rode out on a reconnaissance, accompanied only by his mess sergeant. Suddenly they ran directly into an enemy patrol of 15 men. They were too close to run, so Rommel calmly informed them that Gagiesht had fallen and they were POWs. They should now lay down their arms and join the other captives. Remarkably, the demoralized Romanians did just that. The Württemberg Mountain Battalion was sent back to the Vosges Mountains in February 1917, while Rommel went on furlough and had a second honeymoon trip to the Baltic. The Württemberg Battalion, meanwhile, occupied a quiet part of the Western Front, as the terrain there was terrible and there were no significant military targets nearby on either side of the line. The battalion engaged mostly in training until August, when it was sent back to Romania. Beginning on August the 9th, Rommel was involved in the storming of Mount Kojna. His battalion formed the spearhead. During the assault, a bullet passed through his left arm without hitting a bone or doing any significant damage, but still causing him a great deal of pain. On September the 1st, the Württemberg battalion was sent to Carinthia, southern Austria, for 6 weeks of rest and relaxation. Romania was on the verge of collapse in the latter part of 1917, but so was Germany's main ally, the Austro-Hungarian Empire, which had suffered a string of defeats in the Italian Alps. Vienna cried for help. Berlin responded by dispatching the 14th Army, including the Württemberg Mountain Battalion, which travelled by train through Macedonia to Austrian Carinthia. All totalled, with the three Austrian armies, the Central Powers had 350,000 men facing more than 400,000 Italians, most of whom were demoralised, sick of the war, and ready to go home. The German offensive, which the Italians called the 12th Battle of the Isonzo, began at 2 a.m. on October the 24th. The Württemberg Mountain Battalion now included 11 rifle and machine gun companies. The objective for the offensive was Mount Matajur, a massive and tactically very important position on the Isonzo. Once it was captured, the entire Italian defensive line would be compromised. Mount Cook and the Kolovrat Ridge, which was dominated by Hill 1114, were all part of the Mount Matajur position and had to be taken first. For this operation, Major Spröser gave Rommel the 3rd Rifle and 1st Machine Gun Companies, in addition to his own 2nd Rifle Company, and made them the vanguard for the attack. Each company had about 200 riflemen. It was pouring rain at 6 a.m. when Rommel began his advance. The Italians had constructed 3 defensive lines, featuring barbed wire entanglements and a trench system. Lieutenant Rommel, however, discovered a gully that could serve as a camouflaged path, allowing him to move into the main enemy positions on Kolovrat Ridge before his Kampfgruppe was detected. The mountain troops took several hundred prisoners. Shortly thereafter, an Italian supply convoy pulled up, and Rommel's happy men captured fruit, fresh bread, eggs, and even wine, all of which they rapidly consumed. Meanwhile, Lieutenant Ferdinand Schörner's company of the 3rd Bavarian Life Guards took Hill 1114, and Schörner erroneously reported that he had captured Mount Matayur. General Karl von Bülow, the commander of the 14th Army, had promised the Pour le Mérite to the officer who took this peak. Rommel would capture it, but Schörner got the decoration, a fact that would lead to a long-standing rivalry between the two officers. Fighting in the Alps, the Italians had every advantage of terrain, as they held the defensive position. Rommel and his men, however, managed to infiltrate through enemy lines undetected. At dawn, he launched a surprise bayonet charge against the supporting Italian artillery, while one of his companies struck the enemy front and enlarged the gap, and also masked the sound of Rommel's attack. The sound of the firefight to his front alarmed the Italian commander, who still did not know Rommel was at his rear. Bayonet charges are relatively quiet. He ordered his reserve battalion to restore the front line by counter-attacking. Rommel was waiting for this moment. As soon as the reserve battalion was decisively engaged, Rommel attacked from the rear and surrounded it. Caught in a deadly crossfire, the Italians soon ran up the white flags. Rommel had captured more than 1,000 prisoners. He pushed deeper into the Italian rear, occupied camouflaged ground near the main road to the key fortified position of Mount Matayur, and waited to see what target would present itself. The Italian 4th Bersaglieri Brigade marched straight into the trap. Rommel ambushed the Italian troops, and they were forced to surrender. He took another 2,000 prisoners, including 50 officers. Rommel's next objective was indeed Mount Matayur, a 5,400-foot height to the west, which was the climactic struggle of Lieutenant Rommel's World War I career. Mount Kragonza, also known as Hill 1096, and the secondary summit of Mursli, had to be captured first, however. By the early morning hours of October the 26th, Rommel had been reinforced to a strength of 3 rifle and 3 machine gun companies. Dawn had not yet broken when he took the village of Kragonza on the slope of Mount Kragonza. 1,600 Italians, including 37 officers, surrendered without a fight. The peak of Mount Kragonza, however, had to be taken by main assault. This involved hard fighting, but it was captured at 7:15 a.m. Now, all that lay between Rommel and the summit of Mount Matayur was Mursli. As Rommel advanced, the Italian forces scattered. Some of them were only too glad to be captured. Most of the Salerno Brigade was in the bag. Rommel took another 1,500 prisoners, including 43 officers. At this point, there was confusion behind the German front. Rommel's commanding officer, Major Theodor Sprösser, seeing the huge number of Italian prisoners walking to the German rear, assumed that Rommel had already captured Mount Matayur, and sent orders for the lieutenant to break off the engagement and return to Mount Kragonza. Rommel disobeyed these orders and pressed on toward the summit, where he demanded that the enemy surrender. Thinking he was badly outnumbered, the commander of the 2nd Salerno Regiment raised his hands. Rommel recalled how the captured colonel fumed with rage when he saw how few men Rommel had. In 52 hours, Rommel had captured 2 brigades and several smaller units, totaling 150 officers, 9,000 men, 81 artillery pieces, and the strategically important Mount Matayur. His total strength probably never exceeded 800 men. 6 of his men were killed, and 30 were wounded. Rommel knew, as Stonewall Jackson said, that an army in retreat tends to continue retreating if you press it. He pushed on and captured the important town of Longarone and crossed the Piave, effectively cutting off the Italian 12th Corps. But this time the Italians counterattacked instead of retreating, overran a few German detachments, and almost captured Rommel himself. The next morning, The future desert fox was improving his defensive positions outside the town when, to his surprise, he was approached by one of his own men. Lieutenant Schoffel had been captured the previous evening. Now he showed up riding a mule, followed by dozens of surrendering Italians. He carried a note from the garrison commander, who declared his troops were incapable of offering further resistance. He wanted to surrender. Schoffel had convinced the garrison commander that he was surrounded by an entire German division. Rommel quickly occupied Longarone and captured the entire Italian 1st Infantry Division, 10,000 men, 18 guns, 200 machine guns, 250 wagons, and 10 trucks. For Longarone and his brilliant string of successes, Erwin Rommel was awarded the Pour le Mérite, a medal equivalent to the U.S. Congressional Medal of Honor when granted to such a junior officer. He was personally decorated by Kaiser Wilhelm II. On January the 11th, 1918, Rommel was transferred to the 64th Corps in Württemberg, where, much to his distaste, he occupied a staff officer's slot until July the 29th. Then he was attached to the 4th Battery of the 6th Landwehr Field Artillery Regiment, 6th Bavarian Landwehr Division. Landwehr refers to troops older in age, usually 35 to 45 years old. They were deployed only in the quietest sectors of the front. From August the 20th to September the 8th, Rommel attached to the 1st Landwehr Foot Artillery Battalion of the 20th Corps. He then returned to Württemberg, and he was promoted to captain on October the 18th. Germany capitulated 3 weeks later. Chapter 3. The Reichswehr Years. For some people, the end of World War I was the end of their world. This was especially true in Germany. Survivors such as Corporal Adolf Hitler returned home, but were not quite able to fit into peaceful society. They became part of what was called the Lost Generation. Not so Erwin Rommel. He returned to his wife, rejoined the 124th Infantry Regiment at Weingarten on December the 21st, 1918, and settled down to garrison duty. At home, he enjoyed the quiet life. Here Luzi was the centre of his world. Rommel enjoyed spending calm evenings at home with his wife and the family dog. He had no bad habits and was an easy man to live with. He did not smoke, he rarely drank, other than an occasional glass of wine, never drank to excess, and he never abused or cheated on his wife. When he came home, he left his job outside. The tension of the barracks and the strife of the battlefield did not enter his home until World War II, when Germany's impending defeat and the prospect of Nazi retaliation against him loomed over his head like a huge dark cloud. Even then, he did not take the stress he felt out on his family and friends. At home, he was good-tempered and an excellent fix-it man. He was an avid stamp collector, but practical things interested him even more. He once acquired a motorcycle and disassembled it in the living room just to see what made it run, then put it back together again. Rommel had been married more than 2 years, but because of the war he was essentially a newlywed. He took to marriage enthusiastically. His illegitimate daughter Gertrude was brought into the family as a cousin, and even Walburga was also welcome. In the early and mid-1920s, most Germans could not afford an automobile, and apparently neither could Captain Rommel. But he enjoyed outings in the country, with Luzi hanging on to the back of the motorcycle. He frequently took her to Bodensee, Lake Constance, where he enjoyed swimming and boating. He was good at both, while Luzi later declared that she swam like a lead duck. She was a good water skier, but not so skilled in snow. Rommel was a great athlete and excelled at any physical activity. Eventually he drove his motorcycle to Italy to visit his old battlefields, with his wife still hanging on to his back. When he arrived at Longarone, however, he was indiscreet enough to mention to the locals who he was, and he was asked to leave. The Rommels did everything together, including dancing, skiing, occasionally dining out, canoeing and horseback riding. The only hobby Rommel had in which he was unsuccessful seems to have been the violin, which he played enthusiastically but without a great deal of skill. In short, the Rommels' life together was so uneventful that it might have been considered dull, but it was a life they enjoyed. They were peaceful, loving, comfortable, and happy. Apparently, they almost never fought. Erwin was prone to conceding minor points and letting his wife have her way most of the time. It was a family joke that Erwin always had the last words on domestic matters, and those words were, "Anything you say, Luzi." The famous desert fox was slightly henpecked. In October 1928, Walburga Stemmer died suddenly at the age of 36. Her grandson, Josef Pan, would say that she had committed suicide by taking poison. According to Pan, Walburga always hoped Rommel would come back to her, but when Luzi became pregnant, she at last realized this was never going to happen and killed herself. This claim cannot be confirmed at this late date, but it cannot be refuted either. The most important event in Rommel's married life occurred on Christmas Eve 1928, when his and Luzi's only child Manfred was born. Erwin's family life, however, changed very little. It remained stable and generally undramatic until his death. Germany, in contrast, was anything but stable between 1919 and 1923. Germany's post-war Weimar Republic experienced a period of civil unrest called the War After the War. In March 1919, Rommel was sent to Friedrichshafen on the Bodensee in southwestern Germany, where he assumed command of the 32nd Internal Security Company. It was made up of undisciplined and rebellious Red sailors who jeered at Rommel and his medals, which they found socially unacceptable, would not obey orders and refused to drill. Rommel told them that when he was fighting at the front, he had often prayed to the Lord God Almighty to spare the men of the German Navy. "My prayers were heard, because here you are," he told them. This response surprised and won over most of the mutinous sailors. As for the most insubordinate, Rommel and his NCOs used force to beat them into shape. After the first few days, he had no further trouble out of them, except for the day they were assigned the task of guarding an illegal schnapps factory. Drunken sailors have always been hard for anybody to control. Eventually, the High Command decided that the 32nd was reliable enough to use against communists and anarchists in Münsterland and Westphalia in 1920. When the revolutionaries tried to storm the town hall at Gmünd, Rommel employed fire hoses like machine guns to disperse the crowd, thus sparing himself from having to fire on his fellow Germans. The Treaty of Versailles, which ended World War I, was very hard on Germany. In the long run, it fatally undermined the Weimar Republic and helped pave the way for the Third Reich. In addition to mandating crippling reparations, the treaty denied Germany possession of tanks, submarines, poison gas, and airplanes. It also reduced the size of the German army, now called the Reichswehr or Reichswehr, to 100,000 men, only 4,000 of whom could be officers. Erwin Rommel was one of those selected. He was assigned to command the 7th Company, 124th, 6th Württemberg Infantry Regiment at Weingarten. Initially, the new army was called the Übergangsheer, or Transitional Army. Rommel's parent regiment, the 124th, was among those dissolved, and he was assigned to the 25th Rifle Regiment, Schützenregiment 25, of Reichswehrbrigade 13. On January 1, 1921, this became the 13th Württemberg Infantry Regiment of the new Reichsheer. Rommel stayed in Württemberg very happily until 1929. He commanded the 4th Machine Gun Company of the 13th Infantry Regiment at Ulm until 1924, when he was transferred to the 1st Battalion Staff, also at Ulm. Later, he moved to the 2nd Battalion Staff at Ludwigsburg. In 1925, he again assumed command of the 4th Machine Gun Company, which was now located in Stuttgart, where he remained until 1929. While here, Rommel took his mandatory Wehrkreis exam, required of all officers who had completed 10 years' service. It lasted several days and had two goals. One, assess an officer's professional ability, and two, select men for general staff training. The latter was considered the main path to advancement to the top levels of the army. It was not quite the only path to higher command, but it was pretty close. During the exam, an officer had to write 3 papers on applied tactics, 1 on theoretical tactics, 1 on military engineering, another on map reading and terrain analysis, and another on weapons or equipment. There were also general knowledge questions dealing with history, military history, civics, economic geography, mathematics, physics, and chemistry. The exam was not a rehash of the officer candidate exams, but went well beyond them. It included complicated problems in logistics, resupply, motorized warfare, artillery and mortar fire support plans, and more. It was graded by general staff officers in Berlin. If an officer failed the test badly enough, he was required to take it again. A second dismal performance could cost an officer his commission. Only the top 10 to 15% of the successful examinees were selected for general staff training, and only about 1/3 of these survived the general staff course and got to wear the bright red stripe, called the intelligence stripe, on their trousers. Rommel was not in the top 10 or 15%, so he was not selected for the prestigious course, a fact that may partially explain his hostile attitude toward general staff officers in later years. In 1929, Rommel's battalion commander rated him highly, praising his very great abilities, particularly in the area of terrain analysis, as well as his cheerfulness and tact. "There is more to this officer than meets the eye," he concluded, and he ended by recommending that Rommel be made a military instructor. On October 1, 1929, he was transferred to the infantry school at Dresden. The son and grandson of teachers, Rommel was a natural instructor. He used his own combat experience to stimulate thinking and learning. His lectures were described as always a delight to hear, and one evaluator declared that his officer cadets worshipped him. He was described as a towering personality, a genuine leader, and a first-rate infantry instructor. Promotions are normally slow in small peacetime armies, and the Reichswehr was no exception. Rommel spent almost 14 years as a captain, but in April 1932 he was finally promoted to major. He had been in the army more than 21 years. While at Dresden, Rommel renewed his acquaintance with Captain Ferdinand Schörner, the officer who had been awarded the Pour le Mérite that Rommel deserved for the capture of Mount Matajur. Schörner, a Bavarian whom Rommel had first met in Italy when they were both lieutenants, enjoyed playing practical jokes, and the sometimes overly serious Rommel was a natural victim. Once, at a banquet, Schörner stealthily hid some silverware in Rommel's coat while Rommel was not looking. When Rommel picked up his coat to leave, the silver fell to the floor, making it appear that the future desert fox had been trying to steal it. Schörner enjoyed the joke, but Rommel was less than amused. Later, during World War II, Schörner developed the reputation of being one of Hitler's most brutal generals. He arbitrarily demoted officers for the slightest reason and had enlisted men summarily executed for the smallest infractions. One day, during a visit to Führer headquarters, Rommel pulled Schörner aside and told him he should not use such methods. Schörner ignored him. By then he had been completely brutalized. Promoted to major on October 1, 1933, Rommel was transferred to Goslar, where he assumed command of the 3rd Jäger Battalion of the 17th Infantry Regiment, a mountain unit. He quickly impressed the younger officers and men with his physical endurance. On his first day in command, some of his junior officers invited him to climb a nearby mountain and ski down with them. Rommel accepted the challenge and went up and down the mountain with them 3 times. When Rommel called for a 4th trip, the exhausted captains and lieutenants declined. He was in complete control of his command after that. Rommel insisted that all of his officers learn to hunt, believing that this sport gave them a keener appreciation for terrain analysis, of which he was a master. He also held the 3rd to a higher standard of physical fitness than the other battalions. Rommel himself typically started the day with a 2-mile run. His men knew him as a strict commander, but not a harsh one. He was considered approachable and a man who had their best interests at heart. His men had great confidence in him. He was known throughout the small army for his energy, his determination, his goodwill, his optimism, and his ambition. It was in this posting that Erwin Rommel made his first contact with the Nazis. Adolf Hitler, who had been Chancellor of Germany since January the 30th, 1933, was scheduled to attend a parade at Goslar on September the 30th, 1934. Rommel's 17th Infantry Regiment was slated to pass in review. A young SS man and government liaison officer told Rommel that a single file of SS would stand between the Führer and his battalion. Rommel immediately grew furious at the affront to the Third's honour. This arrangement implied that Hitler needed security to protect him from Rommel and his men. One day he would, but that day had not yet come. Rommel declared that he would not parade his battalion. Uncertain how to proceed, the young SS man, who was clearly in over his head, asked Rommel to speak with Reichsführer SS Heinrich Himmler and Dr. Josef Goebbels, the Minister of Propaganda, at their hotel. Rommel went there at once and tersely explained the situation to Goebbels and Himmler. To his surprise, the top-ranking Nazis apologized. They declared that Major Rommel was perfectly correct in refusing to parade his battalion under those circumstances. There would be no line of SS men. They asked him to please write the entire incident off as a mistake by an overzealous subordinate. Rommel thanked them, the tension subsided, and Goebbels invited him to stay for lunch. Naturally, he accepted. During the meal, Goebbels was charming, as he could be when he desired to be. Apparently, the small, club-footed Nazi divined that Rommel would not always be an insignificant major in a backwoods post. For the rest of his life, Goebbels would go out of his way to befriend the future Field Marshal. During World War II, he even suggested to Hitler that Rommel would make a good commander-in-chief of the army after Germany won the war. For his part, the Swabian was quite impressed with Goebbels, but not at all with Himmler. He never altered his opinion of either man. The parade itself was a success. Rommel's first meeting with Hitler was brief. They were introduced, and the Chancellor complimented the Major on the showing of his battalion. Erwin Rommel's political convictions and ambivalent relationship with the Nazis have been the subject of considerable controversy in recent years. He was somewhat politically naive, and like most Germans, he did support Adolf Hitler at first, at least to some degree. At the beginning of Hitler's political career, he succeeded in portraying himself as an idealist, with some sound ideas about putting Germany back on its feet, militarily and economically. Lützi was more pro-Hitler than Erwin, who was at heart simply a nationalist. Hitler had become Chancellor on January the 30th, 1933, when the Great Depression was at its worst, unemployment in Germany exceeded 24%, and the Weimar Republic was clearly unable to cope with the situation. Like millions of others, Rommel was taken with Hitler's speeches. He considered Hitler's association with some of the cruder Nazis unfortunate, but he was willing to overlook it. Major Rommel and many others dismissed the Führer's more extreme rantings as political hyperbole. It would be years before Rommel realized that Hitler had a propensity for breaking sacred vows, and that much of the extreme Nazi rhetoric that he had dismissed as hyperbole was in deadly earnest. Like most Germans, Rommel was sick of the excesses of the Nazi stormtroops, also called Brownshirts or Sturmabteilung, SA, by 1934. Hitler was also concerned. President Paul von Hindenburg was clearly dying. Hitler feared that the military would impose an anti-Nazi president on him, or possibly even stage a coup to overthrow his government. On June the 30th, he purged the SA in the infamous Night of the Long Knives. Several hundred real and potential political opponents of the regime were also murdered, including two generals. There are two diametrically opposed reports concerning Rommel's opinion of this event. Rommel biographer Desmond Young stated that Rommel believed Hitler's explanation for the purge, which was that SA leader Ernst Röhm a notorious homosexual and thug, was planning to overthrow the government and subordinate the army to the SA. On the other hand, Rommel's chief of staff in 1944, Lieutenant General Hans Spiedel, reported that the Desert Fox said to a friend in 1934, "Now would have been a good time to throw out Hitler and his whole gang." Frankly, I tend to believe Young, but it is impossible to say for sure. Meanwhile, Rommel continued his tour of duty at Goslar. On March 1, 1935, he was promoted to Lieutenant Colonel. Like virtually all Germans, Rommel was delighted when Hitler announced the Treaty of Versailles on March 16, 1935. This delight is no indication of a sympathy for Nazism. Most non-Nazi Germans, and even many anti-Nazis, also praised this move. It gave Germany equal status with the rest of the nations of the world, boosted defence spending, which helped stimulate the economy, and helped eliminate unemployment in both the public and private sectors. Quite apart from helping Germany, renouncing the treaty also had some practical benefits for Erwin Rommel. An expanding military offered him more opportunity for advancement and promotion. Because he had done well as an instructor at Dresden and with the 3rd 17th Infantry Regiment, Rommel was given command of an instructional staff at the Kriegsschule, War School, at Potsdam, which trained Fahnenjunkern. Here he again excelled as a teacher and a leader. The young officers in training were expected to be not only professionally skilled, but socially competent as well. To help them accomplish this task, Rommel recruited an unofficial assistant, Luzi Rommel. The cadets had evenings out where they were taught social graces. Luzi had been a dance student when she met Erwin, so she was well qualified to school the young cadets in manners and dancing. According to cadet Siegfried Knapper, the cadets thoroughly enjoyed their evenings out and dances with Frau Rommel. Because of his proven ability to educate young men, Rommel was given the additional duty of serving as a liaison officer to the Hitler Youth, Hitlerjugend, or HJ, which the Nazis were turning into something of a paramilitary organization. Rommel forcefully objected to the efforts to militarize the HJ. Baldur von Schirach, the head of the Hitler Youth, objected to Rommel's attitude. Rommel pointed out that the children were already contemptuous of academics and were paying far too much attention to sports and military training. The Hitler Youth should place more focus on education and character development, he declared. One word led to another, and the two men were soon in an argument that ended with Rommel telling Schirach that if he wanted to train boys to be soldiers, then he should first go and become a soldier himself. Naturally, von Schirach arranged for Rommel's immediate return to the War Academy. Meanwhile, Rommel wrote a book based on his lectures and World War I experiences. It was titled Infanterie greift an, Infantry in the Attack. Much to his surprise, the book made him wealthy. Germany was militarizing, and Rommel's best-selling book went from one edition to the next. He made so much money, he declared, that he couldn't possibly use it all. And he felt guilty for making money by writing about how other good men had lost their lives. The book also brought about a tremendous and unexpected boost to his career. Adolf Hitler read it and wanted to meet the author. In September 1936, Rommel was attached to Hitler's escort for the Nuremberg party rally. He was tasked with security. When the rally was ending and it came time for Hitler to leave, the Führer instructed Rommel to allow no more than 6 cars to follow him. This order meant that Rommel would have to stop a herd of cabinet ministers, high-ranking party officials, and army generals. Rommel followed the orders, even blocking the road with a pair of tanks. Some of the VIPs were furious, and one of them must have reported him to the Führer, because Adolf Hitler called Rommel in and thanked him for executing the order. Rommel was promoted to Oberst, Colonel, on August 1, 1937, after only 2.5 years as a Lieutenant Colonel. On March 12, 1938, the Anschluss, Hitler's occupation of Austria, occurred. Shortly afterwards, Rommel, who was on detached duty in Berlin, received a choice assignment. Perhaps because Hitler thought highly of him, Rommel was named commander of the war school at Wiener Neustadt in Lower Austria, at the former Theresian Military Academy, Theresianische Militärakademie, which had been founded in 1751. The academy had been the site of the only armed Austrian resistance to Hitler's takeover. The Austrian commandant, Major General Rudolf Tovarek, had manned the defences of the castle against the German Wehrmacht with his cadets, and they refused to surrender for several days. After he capitulated, he was placed on the retired list, but oddly enough, Tovarek was never punished, and he was even allowed to wear his Austrian uniform, a highly unusual honour in those days. Rommel thoroughly enjoyed teaching and supervising the education of young cadets, and his life at Wiener Neustadt was pleasant, if uneventful. He later declared it to be the happiest period of his military career, and his family continued to live there until late 1943, 4 years after Rommel was posted elsewhere. He finally moved Luzi and Manfred at that time, because the Reich had built a factory for the manufacture of Messerschmitt engines there, and he was afraid that his family might be killed in an Allied saturation bombing attack. Had there been no war, he would likely have retired there. The war, however, was rapidly approaching. In the fall of 1938, Rommel was called to Berlin and named commander of the Führerbegleitbataillon, Führer Escort Battalion, during the Sudetenland crisis. As such, Rommel directed Hitler's personal escort. It was an ad hoc combat team consisting of about 2 companies of hand-picked infantry, armed with rifles, machine guns, anti-aircraft guns, and anti-tank weapons. They were not needed, this time. Germany drove to the edge of war before the Western Allies backed down and handed the Sudeten districts of Czechoslovakia over to the Reich. But Hitler was not finished. In March 1939, he invaded the remainder of the helpless Czechoslovakian state. At the critical moment, there was some confusion. How should Hitler enter the capital city of Prague? General of Cavalry Erich Hoeppner, the commander of the 16th Motorized Corps, suggested that he enter the Hradschin, castle district, in an open car. Himmler and his SS security staff were shocked and appalled at this suggestion. Hitler asked Rommel what he should do. "Get into an open car and drive through the streets of the government quarter without an escort," Rommel advised. Hitler took his advice and there were no incidents. After the occupation of Czechoslovakia, Rommel again commanded the Führer Guard Battalion in the occupation of the Germanic city of Memel on the Baltic Sea coast of Lithuania. Again, the Allies did nothing to stop him. During his 3 tours of temporary duty at Führer headquarters, Rommel's admiration for the Führer grew. He already looked upon Hitler as the eliminator of unemployment, and he approved of the dictator's renouncing the Treaty of Versailles and his rebuilding of the military. He was never witness to any of Hitler's temper tantrums or unstable behaviour. For his part, Hitler also liked Erwin Rommel and solicited and respected his opinion. This period of Rommel's life was the closest he ever came to joining the Nazi Party, although he never actually did so. Between his duty trips, Rommel and his family enjoyed life at Wiener Neustadt. Living in the Alps, southwest of Vienna, they went on many excursions and hiking trips into the mountains. Their home, surrounded by a flower garden, was beautiful. There, Rommel devoted himself to a new hobby, photography. But the good times were not to last. A new crisis arose, and Rommel was summoned to Berlin, where he was promoted to Generalmajor, Major General, on August 1, 1939, and named Commandant of Führer Headquarters on August the 23rd. 8 days later, the German Wehrmacht crossed the border into Poland. The invasion of Danzig, which had been declared a free state by the Treaty of Versailles and effectively given to Poland, was the trigger that set off World War II. Rommel was no stranger to Danzig. As a young Fahnenjunker, he had fallen in love and been married there. It was a German town, and these were German people, and he wanted it returned to the Reich, as did practically everyone else in Germany. Rommel and virtually the entire German nation supported Hitler on this issue. Poland refused to return the city or surrender the Polish corridor connecting Danzig to Poland, so Hitler took it by force. He invaded Poland on September 1st. Rommel's Begleit Escort Battalion rode on the Führer's train, America, and included 380 hand-picked men, 4 anti-tank guns, 12 anti-aircraft guns, and dozens of machine guns. The train consisted of more than a dozen coaches, Hitler's personal living quarters, extensive guest quarters, dining facilities, staff quarters, and sufficient communications facilities to make it a command post. Rommel never spent the night here. His Sicherungsbataillon, security battalion, totaling more than 600 men, including 25 officers, travelled by motorised vehicles. Rommel saw Hitler every day and went everywhere with him. The mutual admiration between the two men continued to grow. Rommel had still not been subjected to any of Hitler's rages, temper tantrums, or irrational behaviour. Not yet, anyway. What he saw was Adolf Hitler at his best. During the invasion, Rommel's biggest problem was Hitler himself, who had a constant desire to be right up front with the forward combat troops. Hitler even exposed himself to Polish sniper fire in order to observe the storming of a river line by German infantry. He seemed to enjoy being under fire, Rommel complained. The future Desert Fox also clashed with some high-ranking Nazis, including Martin Bormann, who was Hitler's secretary and the future head of the Nazi Party. Bormann was by nature a bully. He once set a dog on fire because it harassed his mistress's poodle, and he roared with laughter as the poor animal ran howling down the street. It was Rommel's job to only give certain people immediate access to Hitler, and he carried out his orders diligently. Bormann, however, thought himself too important for such orders to apply to him. Naturally, this led to a clash with Rommel, in which Bormann came out second best. The tension between them finally culminated in Rommel's personally informing Bormann that he was headquarters commandant, and Bormann would have to do as he was ordered, whether he liked it or not. An enraged Bormann swallowed the insult, but he never forgot it. He was a murderous Nazi thug who, unlike most of them, knew how to wait. In Poland, Rommel witnessed the Blitzkrieg firsthand. He quickly grasped the importance of speed and of pushing forward with armoured, mechanised and motorised forces, bypassing points of resistance and accepting the risk of being cut off. He learned the value of General Heinz Guderian's maxim, not dribbles, but masses, when it came to armoured warfare. He also learned the value of leading tank formations from the front, as well as the power of combined arms operations, close air support, and air-to-ground coordination. Although he had been in infantry or mountain units for 29 years, and probably had not seen the inside of a tank before 1936, Rommel decided his future lay in the armoured branch. Always imbued with a healthy ambition and never afraid to bypass the chain of command, Rommel approached the Führer and asked for command of a panzer division. Rommel later admitted that this was an immoderate request on his part. Literally dozens, if not hundreds, of officers had a better claim to such a command. In February 1940, Rommel nevertheless arrived in Bad Godesberg on the Rhine to assume command of the 7th Panzer Division. Chapter 4. Blitzkrieg in France. In 1939, the German army began converting 4 former light divisions into panzer divisions. It was one of these divisions which Rommel was assigned to command. Rommel's 7th Panzer Division had only 218 tanks, or about 75% of the strength of the 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th and 6th Panzer Divisions. Far worse, more than half of Rommel's tanks were Czech tanks, manufactured in facilities that had been captured when the Third Reich took over Czechoslovakia in 1938 and 1939. They were designated Panzerkampfwagen 38T, or T-38. The T stood for Czechisch, the German word for Czech. These Czech tanks weighed about 10 tons, had a crew of 4, and mounted both a short-barrel 37mm main battle gun and a 7.92mm machine gun. They were slow, 16 miles per hour on the road and 9.3 miles per hour off-road, and thinly armoured. The Germans increased the armour thickness in vital areas from 10 to 25 millimetres to 50 millimetres, and they added an extra crewman by reducing the number of shells on the tank from 90 to 72. Although T-38s were of little use against French and British tanks, Germany continued manufacturing them until 1942. They made decent assault guns on the Eastern Front, at least in warm weather. In the Russian winters, their transmissions tended to freeze, so they were discontinued. They were, however, mechanically reliable, which was a big advantage in World War II. Some of the German tanks were hardly better. The Panzer Mark I, Panzerkampfwagen I, for example, was originally designed as a training tank. It had a small two-man crew, weighed only 6 tons, and had no main battle gun. It was armed with two 7.92mm machine guns. It was faster than the T-38, with an on-road speed of 31 miles per hour and an off-road speed of 23 miles per hour, but that was its only advantage. General Heinz Guderian, the creator of the Blitzkrieg, said, "Nobody in 1932 could have guessed that one day we should have to go into action with this little tank." The Panzer Mark II, Panzerkampfwagen II, was not much of an improvement. It had a crew of 3 men, weighed 8.9 tons, and had a short-barrel 20mm gun and a 7.92mm machine gun. Later versions carried 20mm autocannons, which fired from 10-round magazines and were used as anti-aircraft weapons. It had a road speed of 25 to 33 miles per hour, depending on the model. Its armour was also thin, offering protection only against small arms fire. The best of Rommel's tanks, of which he didn't have many, was the Panzer Mark III, Panzerkampfwagen III, a medium-sized tank. The H model, Panzerkampfwagen 3H, weighed 23 tons, carried a crew of 5, and had a maximum speed of 25 miles per hour, 12 miles per hour off-road. It also had a 103-mile operational range, the distance it could travel without refuelling. Early models, A through F, had a long-barrel 37mm main battle gun. Later models, a 50mm main battle gun. They all had two or three 7.92mm machine guns. The armour of the Panzerkampfwagen 3H, however, was thin. 15mm in early models, 30mm in models D through G, and 50mm in J models. It should perhaps be noted here that it is a German characteristic not only to have many models of every weapon and armoured vehicle, but also to make them as complicated as possible. Rommel's newest tank was the Panzerkampfwagen IV. Its top speed was 26 miles per hour on the road. It had a crew of 5, commander, gunner, loader, driver and radio operator machine gunner, and up to 80mm of armour, but its main battle gun was a short-barrelled 75mm weapon that severely limited its range and penetrating power. It was effective against bunkers, but not against enemy tanks. Erwin Rommel arrived in Bad Godesberg on February 10, 1940, succeeding Lieutenant General Georg Stummer, who had moved up to the command of the 40th Motorized, later Panzer, Corps. Ignoring the fact that it was a Sunday, Rommel called an immediate inspection. He found his men to be in no better shape than their tanks. The men were from the province of Thuringia, which was not noted for producing good soldiers, and they did not pass inspection. When he finished, Rommel passed out copies of Infantry in the Attack for everyone, and sent all of his regimental commanders on leave, telling them that he wouldn't need them until he had learned the ropes himself. Rommel was up at 6 a.m. every morning and ran a mile before breakfast. He had grown overweight and out of shape during the 6 months of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.